Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. I'm sitting in very nearly in the seat of power up here in Kidderminster. Mal's in the seat of power. It's Mal Story. We're Mal Story's tackle shop here. He's got two tackle shops, one in Kidderminster, one in Hell's Owen. He's a barbel specialist. I love barbel fishing. And Mal, you're going to take us to a stretch tomorrow. And apparently, the latest, it's not a craze, it's a method that's catching at the moment, is hemp and casters, and I guess with the feeder. Tell us a little bit more about it.
Well, that's right. Pellet's been the dominant force for the last few years, but we've noticed probably a little bit last season, particularly the start of this season, the casters and hemp, which is what we used to use years ago, have come back into their own, so they're sort of that's doing the business at the moment. So that's quite good. There's a few being caught on maggots, but I think they're, suffice to say, those using mags are getting pestered with perch about £2 a piece.
Nice perch, which nice is a
lovely, lovely perch, but when you have the barbel. But casters and them, yeah, certainly the thing. Pellets have just fallen by the wayside a little bit, but that's not to say that they don't still catch on pellets. Favourite trick, really, is if you get some very small pellets, halibut pellets, like 3 mil,
yes,
mix your casters and hemp as you'd normally do when we're fishing, put them through a feeder. Just put a few of the 3 mil halibut pellets in with the casters and hemp, fish casters and hemp, and at some stage if it goes off or you're not catching, then you can always put a pellet on the hook, knowing that you've introduced a little
bit into
the water.
Like a sort of bonus.
Yes, that's correct.
Give you a bit of a backup, so you've got a second bait to try, should you so want it.
That's right, that's right. So, you know, that's a little tip, really. That's
now, where are we going to be fishing tomorrow up here? Tell us exactly about the stretch.
Well, we're going to go on the Kidderminster and District AA water. It's become, some of the pegs have become a bit neglected over the last few years. Pegs that were good at one time, or they've been sort of, I suppose the fish have disappeared off the pegs and they've got left and not fished and they've become overgrown. This time the association have taken it on themselves to do an awful lot of work from top to bottom along the water, cut pegs out that have not been used for years. And we'll head for KDA water and see if we can find a peg that'll throw us a few barbel up.
Fingers crossed, fingers crossed. Now, feeder fishing, just give the old YouTube followers we've got an idea what type of feeder will we be using. You know, size of holes and weights and that sort of thing, hook links.
The feeders that we sort of most people use are the Camasan black cap feeders, which are absolutely ideal. You can get them in various weights from 10, 20, 30, 40 gram and up to 50 gram. Normal river, 40 grams, 30 to 40 gram is about right on a normal river, depending on the peg that you're on. So one of those two, 50 grams, you know, maybe if there's a little bit of water and it's pulling through a bit harder. So I'll show you the black cap feeders. Those are the best ones, really.
Sure. Different hole sizes are they all pretty much the same?
Yes, the dispersing holes are basically all the same size. Sometimes the problem is the cap on the bottom. You take the top off to put the bait in. The cap on the bottom has got three holes. Occasionally you'll find that you might get some casters and hemp or whatever bait you're using stuck in the bottom of the feeder.
Yep.
If that starts to happen, then you can join two of those holes up in like an elongated
slot. I see. Make
which just allows them to all come out, because you want everything out of the feeder, you know, to come out of the feeder when it's in.
And hook length, what would you recommend, lines and hook
length? The old favourite Scroft.
Yes, I've still got that. Well, the same spool you gave me last year, that's a year old.
Well, you've kept it in the dark.
I have indeed, yeah.
But going back years, we used to use Bayer line, which was either 3-2, 2-6, 3-2 or 4-4. Generally speaking, it was 3.2. Now, if you take the thickness of 3.2 Bayer, which I think off the top of my head is 0.20, right, then look at Scroft 0.20 thickness, and see the breaking strain of that, it's about £8.
Oh, really?
So obviously, if you're using the same thickness of line, but it's much stronger, then you're better off doing that than sticking to the old flavoured stuff. So that's what I'd be using, some Stroft. I mean, I use that for everything. You know, if I go trout fishing, I'll use it on the trout leader and tie droppers on.
Yeah.
And it's really good on the knot strength.
Well, you put me onto it, man. I've used it like margin fishing for carp and stuff like that, and I love it to death, you know. I don't have a problem with it at all. I've not had it pop.
Touch wood.
It's good. I do like that one. Yeah. Now, hook sizes. Is there a special hook for caster fishing?
Well, you need something strong. A forged hook, microbarb. That's quite strong. Drennan Super Specialist are very good. They are eyed. I've still got in my box some Mustad 31381s, which they haven't made for years. Which is a very strong hook. Crystal bend. Never open up. You four or five fish and they go a little bit blunt. While I've still got some of those left, I'll still use those. Yeah, but like I said, the Drennan hooks are very good, super specialist.
And what about hook sizes for casters? You're fishing two or three casters on a hook?
Well, some people look a bit gone out sometimes when they come in, because I suppose the best selling size of hook are like 12s, then it's the 14s the best seller. But if I revert back to how it was years ago, we used to start with a 16. If you're getting plenty of bites and plenty of fish, you could step that up to a 14. But more often than not, you'll have a couple of fish and then they get a bit wary of the hook size. And they do get wary of the hook size, whatever anyone says, especially when you've got the middle of the day fishing, you know, the sun on the water. So then you'll be dropping down to 18s and even 20s. And people go, 20s, never on a 20. But but that does make all the difference in the world, is dropping down hook size, dependent on the conditions, especially if it's clear and sunny.
And that's coming from your match fishing background,
precisely.
You've got the confidence to use a hook that size, because you know that's possibly going to give you the edge to win a match.
That's right, yeah, I think that is right. But of course, a lot of people tend then to go, if you start off with an 12-inch to 18-inch length hook length, if that's not working, people tend to go longer and longer. Well, that will work. But the problem you've got, I think I've said to you before, you hook a barbel, you're out of sync, you're trying to play it, you've got the feeder out of the water, and there's too much length between the feeder and it's pulling against all the time, it's pulling against the fish, and that then you can easily
pop the hook off.
It will pull out if you're not careful. So don't go too long, you know, certainly no longer than 3 feet.
Yeah.
But the average of about 18 inches to 2 feet is what we'd hope to be catching on.
Now, I bought a bag of regular trout pellets that I got from one of the trout fisheries. You mentioned about putting trout pellets in there, small size, before to help sort of bulk out, and then you can always put them on as a hook bait if you wanted to
try it.
Can I sort of crunch that? Is it worth crunching up to like a powder to put in with the hemp and casters? Or you don't use ground bait, that's what I'm trying to get.
No, so, I mean, again, you get some people coming along that do use ground bait, the marine halibut ground bait. I'm not a fan of using ground bait on the middle seven.
Yeah.
I just think it's the speed of the current is so fast that when it's in, it's gone.
Yeah.
You know, you tend to do that sort of fishing with ground baits and that sort of thing on the lower seven where the river's much lower. And they tend to use their bigger feeders, go in a few times, put plenty of stuff down on the bottom, and then sit there and wait for a big barbel, you know, sort of, they aim for a double figure barbel. That's what they'd be aiming for, really.
And as well as the barbel, which we know are in the seven, were other species, char, perch, that sort of stuff in there we might pick up?
I would be surprised if we didn't pick some chub up, that's for sure. So perch, if you put maggots on, I'd say yes, you'd probably catch perch.
Yeah.
And if you put a float on and run maggots through, you'll be catching dace as well.
Yeah, so good mixed fishing up here.
It is very good, yeah.
This will go right through the winter, won't it, as well?
If the river level stops down in the winter, you can't get better float fishing than you can in this area. I mean, we're blessed with fishing. We're surrounded by it, you know.
Rivers, lakes, everything.
We're surrounded by it. We're spoilt for choice. And of course, we've got this little river that runs through Kidderminster, Wolverley and beyond, the little River Stour, and places you can jump across it. And the quality of the fish in there now, and barbel, chub, it's just amazing. You can go into the town centre at Kidderminster, stand by is it T-Max, and stand on the wooden footbridge and look over, and people drop bread in there, and you'll see a massive shoulder chub and barbel underneath them. It's just incredible to see in a river that years ago, when the carpet factories and the carpet industry were in full force, they changed colour daily. The
would colour they really?
Yeah. It was just polluted, and you know. But now the quality is.
It's right back where it should be.
It is, yeah. And there's so much free fishing on this River Stour. It's incredible.
Well, I can get in touch with you in a tackle shop. One assumes to find all the different stretches if people want to find out where that free fishing is.
Yes.
And you sell day tickets there as well.
That's correct. We sell Kidderminster and District day tickets, Birmingham Anglers day tickets, and season cards for the Kidderminster. Birmingham Anglers, you have to, if you want a season ticket, you have to get it directly from their office in Hagley. And then we can sort of point you in the direction where there's a bit a day ticket where they come and collect the money on the bank, or, you know, as I said, a lot of the River Stour, which basically follows the canal through Kidderminster and down to Stourport where it enters the River Severn. There's a lot of free stuff down there. I don't think anyone knows who owns it. It's overgrown, it chops its way in a little.
Yeah, taking away.
Yeah,
well, Mal, you've given us some information there. And you mentioned the words, you can point them in the right direction, i.e. you can do it with the customers. You've got to do it with me and Mike now because we want to catch a barbel. Guys, let's get out on the river and see, can he talk the talk or walk the walk, or which one's he going to do? Let's get walking ourselves and see what we can find.
Well, these are the casters we use. As you can see, they can't come, and when they've been turned, they're in a variety of shades. My own personal choice is to have them as dark as it's possibly to have them, but sinking. That's the way I prefer them. So, and then when we're doing a mix, yeah. I probably would be putting a pint of casters to about a pint and a half of hemp. Now, one thing you need to notice about the hemp, if you look at this hemp here, it's particularly good quality. Got lots of where it's been boiled, lots it's split. And you've got all those little white pieces coming through there, and that's perfect for barbel. They love them. Now, some hemp you can get, it's not very it's very green. And they won't split, and that hemp isn't very good. It's hard, it just won't split. You need a good quality of hemp. So what we normally do before we buy from our supplier, we order a bag first, try it to make sure it boils nicely and splits like that, and then we buy the same batch and have a ton at a time, and that's how it ends up.
So a ton, didn't you?
I did, yeah. a ton at a time, yeah. Strange enough, these days it comes in 15 kilo bags, is where it used to come in 25 kilo sacks. But we've been putting about a pint and a half of that to a pint of casters, so you know that would be the mix of the two together.
And how long can you keep those casters, you know?
Well, I suppose they would keep for about, in a tub like that, they keep for about 10 days before they start to go off. When I say go off, they sort of start to smell a bit. But we don't keep them that long. We sell them that fast and turn them over that fast.
What volume would you get through, Mal?
With
your two shops? You've got one here and one in Howells Owen.
I suppose we're probably talking a couple of hundred pints a week.
Really?
Between the two shops, maybe a bit more through the summer period, you know. So sometimes we buy a few in. And sometimes we also turn quite a few ourselves. We've got a cellar downstairs here, so, you know. We do turn some and buy some.
Non-stop bait making.
That's right, yeah.
Guys, we've been here probably what, half an hour. We've had a right kerfuffle with the baits trying to get them out. It's quite a bit of jungle fishing at times. And this one's just over the ledge halfway through the river. We're just casting over the ledge, and I've got a nice perch on here. Nice markings. Let's see if we can get them out for you.
On the casters?
On the double red casters, dark red.
A nice perch, yeah. I've got to zoom right in on that one.
I'll just get them unhooked.
Just about out to where that shadow V line is there. I'm going to point to it so they know. Around about where the white of the shadow line, there's a ledge dropping off like this. And I've gone upstream and I'm firing in some leftover dog biscuits, and the chub are coming up and taking them. It's right where Mal said cast. So we figure that's a distance just off the ledge there.
Right.
Let's have a look at the perch.
Ready?
Yep.
Well, there we go, folks. Lovely, nice looking perch, nice and healthy. Quite an aggressive take, actually. Dorsal's been a bit battered, a bit of a warrior, this one.
He's been in the wars.
Yeah, he's been in the wars, this one, but lovely orange tinge to the fins there. And that is a nice looking perch. And the main thing is, it's a fish.
From Bewdley.
Something's on the bite. Let's hope we can get that barbel.
All right.
It's probably got loads of energy, this one. Off he goes. Well, after many tangles and bird's nests and pretty much everything that could go wrong, half an hour later, into the second, well, third fish actually, I had a really baby chub before the palaver happened with the tangles. And I'm not quite sure what it is yet, but quite a positive bite. I've got them on the same line, these two rods, in the just over halfway through the river, halfway across. I can't see what it is yet.
I've got my glasses on. Put my glasses on.
Yeah, I've got polaroids on, but I can't see it. It's
small
a perch.
Chub. Another perch. Another perch.
Yeah. Lovely markings on this one.
Never look down there.
Proper stripey. Nice aggressive take. Top of the world, now I'm living. And the good just gets better, keeps a giving. Not even close to the end, it's just beginning. Life is getting lighter while the days are getting brighter, yeah. And that's a good, I won't even worry anymore. Took all my cares, took and kicked them all out the door. Go on and try, come and tell me what you're waiting for. Move and keep them going till your life is overflowing, yeah. I do a dance, do a dance. Another nice small perch. Lovely markings again. This one's in a bit better condition. Lovely dorsal there. I love that about the perch, their dorsal fin. But still not the target species, but we're happy catching. Let's get this one back. I have been, don't jump over, I've been piling the perch out. I think I've had about 8 perch in the last hour and a half. Had a real funny bite now. I just went to wind the feeder in. Thought it was a snag and there's something on it and I can see it sliming through the water and I think I've got an eel, which is probably my first ever eel, actually. I don't think I've ever caught a freshwater eel.
It's a PB!
It is, another PB. It's going nuts. Only a tiny hook.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like an eel to me.
Yeah. Another species.
That's a swinger.
I'll bring him up there.
Not quite the conger we normally do, but... He will be. Bring him up here, I say. Hold him like that. Stay there.
First ever eel.
There's a song about that in the Second World War. Did you know that, made up about them?
What's that?
He'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when. Taken a leaf out of Mike's book and I've changed over to Hemper casters on the feeder, but instead of running it through the black cap feeder, I'm using ground bait, mixing it all up in the ground bait, the Hemper casters in the ground bait, open-ended feeder, a lighter one because the flow is very slow here, and a nice perch. I've had an eel before that and he may well come off because I think this is a barbless.
It's a nice fish.
But we're getting some, I'll show you this one. Getting some decent sized perch. He's just nicked in the corner. Just hold him, just rinse him off. There we go. Get his fin out for you. Same as Mike got. Mike got a nice one early on. So it's nice to get a good fish. It'd be nice to get a barbel, but do you know what? How many perch you have, Mike?
13 now, I think.
13,
yeah.
Oh, it's unlucky. So I've only got 12 to go to draw a level. But there you go, nice perch, just get him back. Coming down. Mike's on, guys, we just changed swims. Mel's come down, he's lost a fish, Mike's lost a fish. That's a barbel,
That is, look at the bend in that rod.
I know, this
just
is,
keep it smooth.
It's exactly where we lost one just now on a snag.
Right on the snag, and he's going to be digging for it. Look
and
at that tip.
The rows are turning around up there.
Look at the bend of the rod, guys. Are we going to get lucky? Please, Lord, watch, we need a break. Rod. I'm going to put the camera down. I'm going to get the other rod out of the way, okay?
Yep. Oh, look at the boil.
Don't go too far down. Just kick your drag. Keep that. Don't go lower angle to that with the rod. Okay. Just let him kick. You know it's a barbel. He's digging.
Oh, the boils.
Oh no, oh no. I know what the nerves are like. It's going to go ping.
Every fisherman hates this bit when you fished all day
for one fish
and had a disastrous day.
I can't see what it is still.
Steady with it, steady with his old school grand pulling straight through 8-pound line job.
The rowers will be on their way back soon.
No, he's coming. He is coming. Nice and smooth. Just keep the same bend in the rod.
Oh, it's a nice fish. That was a nice tail. Come on, puppy.
Now, ease your drag a touch. Okay. He's not done yet, it's barbell, don't forget. Just so you've got it, you can always finger pressure the fish.
Yeah. He's got a nice tail on him. I think it's a nice fish.
Just on even.
Get that net ready, I don't want to miss the
fish. I wonder if it's... I know, I've taken
it. Oh, it's a good fish.
You see, he's got the nerves, people. He's got the nerves.
I think it's
tip high. Just play it like a matchman.
Yeah, but I want to get this in.
Yeah, but just watch the tip of your rod. Watch the tip. I can't, I've got no chest waders. I'm going to try and net it with one hand. Let me net it with one hand and you manage it. I think you can do it. Just take your time. Don't go too far out and spook it. Here we come. Slowly, slowly. No, it's going to boil.
This is nervous.
That's why you go barbell fishing.
Nerve-wracking stuff. I am nervous. Come on, puppy.
He won't. It's a barbell. He can go any time.
Come on, puppy.
I'd walk backwards. You might want another drop on the reel. Just take one more turn. Shorten him a little bit slowly. These are our friends over here, folks, in case you wanted to know. We've all had an altercation with them several times and had abusive language telling us to F off fishermen, which is nice and considerate, you know.
A PB barbel.
A PB barbel and Henley Bigatta.
Oh, shit, come on.
You see the fish. Don't scoop at him. Gently.
Oh.
You got him?
That's my PB,
it's
gotta be.
I don't know, he's about the
that's
same
a
as
nice
the other
fish.
One. Yeah, he's the same as the other one, that's no, a barbel.
That's a nice fish. I'd like to weigh this one.
Oh god, I don't know where the scales are, mate, up on the cliff.
You can get them, I want to weigh it.
Now, I'll tell you, that might be close to five.
I want to weigh it just so I can get
4 pounds your biggest, that'd go four, bigger than four,
four
I think.
Yeah.
I'd say he's about 4'12". 4'12". Just rest him in the water there. Yeah. Head upstream, right, we get the scales.
I'd like to weigh it just for my records.
The moment of truth. Get him in a weigh bag.
Into the weigh sling.
It's worth driving a couple hundred miles, so I know.
Oh,
that's going to
definitely.
Do...
Come on, PB.
Well, it's well over four, certainly a PB. I'm going for...
Are we zeroed the scale?
Yeah, it's all done. I would say about five... I mean, you might get 5'12" on it. I've done all that.
Here we go.
5'12".
Might go settle. We're into 5'13".
5'13", yeah.
That's a PB.
Graham's 1 ounce out.
5'13". Let's have a look at
that's a good one. Grab a still of that too.
That is. There's the evidence.
Yeah.
5'13". And this is one hell of a nice fish. I do love barbell. They're a whole new ball game.
I'll tell you what I call that. A beaudly beauty.
That is stunning fish. The waist thing's not even big enough.
Wait till you get a big one.
There we go. Look at that. There we go.
That's a good fish, isn't
well,
it? Yeah.
That's a totally awesome
that's
fish.
That's a totally awesome fish after 10 hours of fishing.
That is something else, that barbel. All pure muscle.
What were we going to pack up? But Mal said move, swim, so we've moved downstream. First cast, and here come our friends again.
Absolutely.
In the distance.
Beauty. We're going to get a couple of stills, and then we'll get this one back, and
yep.
Hopefully see if we can get another one.
Yep.
Awesome. Now, so let's get this one back. Up river. What a beaut. A new PB, I shall remember you. Let it recover a bit. What an unbelievable fish. Cracking fight with rowers everywhere. The odds were against me on this one. That is an awesome fish, isn't it? Look at the pec fins on that.
Yeah, powerful one.
Yeah. Here he goes. Getting some oxygen around the gills.
When they do that jerk, there's gas in their stomach. Put his head right up into the current.
It's going deeper because there's a lot.
Put his head up. No, it's not depth. Put his head into the current. That's it, straighter. Well done, away he goes.
I mean, we were fishing in a little bit Mickey Mouse because I come down in a rush and using someone else's tackle, I've managed to make a few packets of hooks with me, etc. Got the correct size feeder on there, which is 40 gram black cap, filled with casters and hemp. And we hope that's going to tempt a barbel. Got quite a long hook length on there.
What would you say, it's about a good 2 feet or more, isn't it, Mal?
I'd say it's about 2.5 feet, that hook length.
Yeah.
And
these rowers that come past, you say it actually sparks them up sometimes.
It does. It affects the anglers more than it does the fish, I have to say.
So, yeah, it does, yeah. I agree there.
A little bit irate grey, don't they? Yeah. But the first casting, it settled and it went straight over.
Really?
That snagged up. But what I found since is someone has left a line in, there's a line across there.
Oh.
Heavy line as well.
Yeah, Mike had as well then. Coming downstream.
Yeah, it's a heavy line too.
Yeah.
So
that's what we felt when we were up there. I said, I can feel. I was walking backwards for a break. I could feel it juddering. You know, people think I've got a stutter now.
But now there's a line over there, so I've come a little bit further down than I wanted.
Now listen, we've been struggling all day. Yeah. Give us the tip now, because obviously Mike's had that fish. Evening, is it, you think? I mean, it's a classic time, isn't it, later in the day?
Yes.
Or the moving swim bit. What made you come to these swims and make us move? Because we were all for packing up. So what made you move us?
What made you mean?
No, yeah, because you moved us, yeah.
Basically, where you are up there, there's a rock ledge that comes out. Well, it's from the inside going out, really.
Yeah.
And you need to be throwing over that ledge, which is a 3/4 throw.
Yep.
You've got these rowers coming past, so, you know.
Too far, we're going to get picked up.
We're going to get picked up too many times. So by coming to these pegs here, you can see where the boil is over the far side.
Yes.
There's a ledge there, pronounced ledge there, and it comes across. And you know what I'm doing, I'm not having to throw so far out. So as you can see, I don't know whether you've noticed the same there. We haven't had any problem. I haven't had a problem with the rows at all yet.
Now you said also if they do come in close, because bear in mind they can't always see us behind the bushes and stuff, just drop your rod and lower it down.
That's right.
And let them go over the top.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let it go over the top, and it does affect the anglers more than the fish, because. Going back a few years, we used to, you know, fish the evening opens here at Bewdley, 6:30 till 9:00, and the rows, as we started, the rows would come up in great force, and it seemed to spark them off. As
really? So they might have been lethargic during the day.
Yeah, yeah.
So you just drop your rod or anything, or are they going to go straight over it?
No, I think it
was okay. Just pulls out of position, but he didn't pick it up.
No. It's not that line again. No, but I won't worry too much about the rowers.
So the importance really of fishing is reading these swims. Obviously, local knowledge you cannot dispute is what you need really.
Absolutely.
So they need to come into your shop. Give anybody a call, get hold of a local fishing club or something like that.
There are quite a number of experienced anglers about, and they'll, you know, a lot of them know the run of the. Of the pegs, like I said to you when I sent you here this morning, the ones that you've been on that fence, there's a ledge, and you must get over that ledge and into the gully, which is where they live, basically. But the unfortunate thing is, Graham, you've come along, we've had two really good weeks at the start of the season where there was a tinge of colour and an inch or two of water on.
Yeah.
The third week, it wasn't quite so good, and this last week, it's awful.
It's tailed off. It's tailed off.
It's tailed off.
Mike's got one anyway, but this is fishing, you just got to take it as it comes.
That's right, that's absolutely right, yeah. But we need some rain, and here we are praying for rain.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
A match that would be fished on the evening, 2.5 hours.
Yes.
The weights would be as good, if not better, than a 5-hour match in the daytime.
Oh, is that right?
10 to 3, that's how it used to be, yeah.
Well, it looks a bit barbary, doesn't it?
Oh. I reckon it feels a bit eely to me. But
oh, yeah, we had a couple of eels this morning.
I've got to keep the rod down a bit now, just in case.
So you don't have a problem sinking in the water, but obviously you run a bit of a risk of getting a snag there, I suppose. But it's...
Well, you do, but of course over the years you get to know the pegs where the snags are and things like that, you know. I don't think it's a barbel.
You don't think it is, Mark?
No, I think it's an eel. But
do you get big eels in it?
Yeah, you do get some very good eels. That's coming close in there.
He's coming in now.
Just on the inside flow. But did you notice the bite was when the boat was going by?
That's true, absolutely.
Or did you just come by one of the other? I can't quite remember.
I'm going to forgive all those rowers that were hurling me obscenities that we shouldn't be fishing there. Oh, chub is it? Or a big perch? Oh, that's a big perch. That's a good mouth.
Yeah, but there you go. We didn't catch a barbel yet. But... And he's perfectly lip-hooked there.
He's just got him on the edge, hasn't he?
Yeah, just on the edge. There you go. So that's... Nice perch. What would that be? Pound and a quarter?
I'll give that a pound and a quarter of anybody's money, yeah.
And beautiful markings, as you can see. with the big fin on it. You've got to watch out here, I'm only fishing a little hook.
Small hook have you got?
Yeah.
What size?
20.
20?
I'm sure we could try and get a bite now, I don't think it's snag. No, it's not.
I just lost one in the snags. Oh, he's still going.
Did you catch a piece of line over that other side?
Yeah, second
really,
time.
Really heavy piece of line. It was, you know, I threw on this bigger on the mat. You only throw slightly, see that boil is slightly upstream,
yeah.
And it's down there. I pulled it and got it halfway.
Yeah.
I've took quite a bit of line off this reel because it curled it all up.
Yeah, it's annoying. It's right where the fish tend to know it's there as well. Mm-hmm. I think they just go for it. He's in. Do you find if you let them go slack, they tend to
quite often
free up?
Free up, yeah. Depends how bad that's, if it's under a ledge or a rock,
yeah,
they'll usually come out, but if it's line or something else.
Unfortunately, that piece of scrap line was a snag too much for Mel's barbel and he lost it. Just unfortunate, do not lose line in the river. You can, guys, it can't be helped, but this was really strong line, it's no need to use it. And then you're left with the tranquility and peace of a summer evening on the river. It is the barbel fisherman's domain, and that's why we go barbel fishing. Scenes like this, just absolutely on tent hooks, waiting for that rod top to fold right over with a nice barbel.
Guys, might just take a load of gear back to the car. Justice will be seen to be done here. Just watch my rods, he said. Watch my rods? I'm watching my rods. Fish on, barbel, not as big as Mike's. But I tell you what, never was a fish so gratefully received as they, you know, those ones you get last knockings. Mind you, I haven't got it yet, have I? This one, I actually went on the lead. I thought I'm going to try and bump the lead round rather than have the feeder, and I put a great big gobful of casters on there, like 10 casters on a rolling ledger rig, and it worked. They took it, so it just shows you this one was down the back. I threw it down the back of the swim. Better go and get this fish for you.
Oh, I love it! I love it. It's about. Let me show it to you. It's about 4 times. I'm going to keep him in the water, this one.
You
go
in?
On. Hang on, okay,
hold
got
on.
One
we got a fish here.
Right. Oh, there we go, guys. So pleased with that one. Thus, end of the session. Very, very last minute. But it gets worse because Mal's got one over there as well. He's got no net. He brought that tackle. Here we go. Let's get this fish back. Put him in here, head first. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And that one was just on rolling, just a rolling swan shot, big hook and a bunch of casters. And they're on those casters big time now. But get down there, Mike, film Mel's one.
Yeah, I'm off.
Net, you got the net.
Oh, yeah.
Coming, hang on.
You've got it, Mel. Oh, not another one. Really? Same snags?
Oh, yeah, came the foot there. Same snags, it's like a piece of line or something.
It's, oh, it's horrible, isn't it? Is this one, this one's free though, is it?
He's close in.
There's your net anyway, Mel.
Thank you.
And you're still on the hemp and casters, aren't you?
That's right, yeah. Sort of on the inside, fast bit just in
there. Was it just in there?
Yeah. See him.
There he is. Yep, there's the boil. Definitely a fish. He's in. Get in. Yes. Another one. Bites the dust. There we go. Another fine River 7 barbel. Gone. Brilliant.